In Lagios, okay, we deal with objects, right? What are the objects? Object is anything that is involved in monitoring and notification. What are the types of objects which we have? We have discussed about it. We have services, service groups, we have host and host groups, we have contact and contact groups, and then we have commands which basically interact with plugins, and then we have time periods, we have escalations, and then we have notification and execution dependencies. Now, where are these configurations defined? Right, these configurations can be defined in any file, okay, but to define that configurations, what we need to do is we need to basically follow some syntax, and that syntax is something which Nagios calls it as object definitions. That syntax is something which Nagios calls it as object definitions. So you basically create a configuration file and then you link it to your main Nagios file. In our installation mechanism, that main Nagios file is present in user local Nagios at cnagios.cfg, right? And then basically, once you define it correctly, then basically you need to link it up. You need to link it up by writing one more cfg underscore file section. Cfg underscore dir, we will do it after we add little bit of more stuff, right? So the first thing which you would try to do is, okay, create one Linux machine and add it to your monitoring. Using Nagios. So my first step would be create a Linux VM. So in this class, I am using AWS to do that. So I'd quickly go over here. Okay. And then I would say that I want to create one more machine. Okay. EC2. Okay. So let me select a Red Hat virtual machine. It doesn't matter which machine it is. Now I'm taking this machine. I'll go over here. Okay. And this machine, let me call this machine as web server for the sake of it. Just for the sake of it. Okay. And at this moment, I'm opening all the ports. So all TCP is open. And I will try to launch it. So if you see, right, so instance state is running. Let me wait for that machine to be up. Good. I'll select this web server. So I have created this web server. Okay. And if you look at this web server's IP address, private IP address is this, public IP address is this. Okay, private means it can connect within the same network. Public means it can connect within any network, Okay, right? And this is a machine which I would be basically using initially. So okay. Now, what is that we have added? Host or a service? What is that we have added? Host or a service? Host. Thank you. So, host is a device, right? So, since we have a new host now, let's add, what definition shall we add? Host definition. Let us add host definition. Okay. So the host definition syntax would be over here. So I'll go into the documentations, scroll down, and let me click on host definitions. Okay. So if you look at this host definitions, are you seeing something in which is in red color? Okay, So whatever is in red color is mandatory. You have to write it down. You have to write it down. Okay. They are mandatory for you. Okay. Clear on this, sir? Whatever is in red color is basically something which is mandatory for you. So you have to write it down. Okay. So whatever is in the other colors, they are all optional fields. So it is your choice. It is your choice. So shall we define this? Okay. Now, what you do is create a new. Okay. Let me call that machine as webserver.cfg file. Webserver.cfg file. So for doing this, what I would try to do is, okay, let me go to C drive. Let me go to DevOps. Okay. Over here, let me create a folder called as Nagios. Okay. So let me open this folder with Visual Studio Code. Okay. So in this, I'll be creating a new folder, which I'll be calling it as initial. Okay. Right. I would call it as initial because we are still learning. And over here, I'm creating a file which is called as webserver.cfg. Am I clear on this? Right. And then here I need to follow the syntax. What is the syntax which it is trying to tell? Define a host. So let me write it down. Define host. Okay. Initially, let us put only some of the fields which are required. So what is the first required field? Host underscore name. So let me give host underscore name. And then you can give some spaces over here. And in host name, what is this host name field? Okay. So host name is basically name of your host. Okay. So you can give any name over here. So let me call this host name as web server. Let me call this name as web server. Okay. So are we clear on this? Host name is the short or unique name of your host. Okay. Then if you want to call this machine with a different name, you can always call it. You can give some alias name. Okay. But it's okay. Let us basically go with the next section. What is the next required field? Address. So let me try to do address. So in address, basically I can give a public IP address or a private IP address. But since these two machines are in the same network, let me give private IP address. If you want, you can give public IP address also. Nothing will, because since we have opened all the ports, it doesn't matter now. It doesn't matter now. Okay. Right. Now let us go back to the next stuff. Okay. I have given address. Then the other thing which we need to basically tell is, okay, what are these max check attempts? What are these max check attempts? So it tries to tell you that how many times a test needs to be performed before it reports host is down. Before it reports host is down. So I will try to tell max check attempts. And let me give the value as 3. Okay. And then what is the required field over here? Check period. Okay. So in check period, I need to tell what is the time period when it should basically check for the time period that has been configured. Okay. So, but right now we don't have any time period configurations, right? But for doing this activity, what we would end up doing is, let me have a look at existing file. So are you seeing this file? I'll copy this file. Okay. Right. Okay. So, and I will try to basically open this file. Okay, so localhost dot configuration. Okay, so are you seeing any time period over here? No, we don't see any time period. Okay, But there is this interesting term called as use Linux server. Okay, fine. We will come back to that, what that is. Okay. So, and if you see over here, there is a folder called as objects. And in this folder, there are loads of things that are basically defined. And now, in here, I have a file which is called as timeperiods.cfg. Okay. So, what is the time period name which I am seeing over here? Okay. There is already this time period name which is defined. Okay. You can define your own time period, or you can basically rely on the time periods that are shown to you. Okay. So, if I basically look into this, I can use any of the time periods that are defined over here. So, I will use a time period which is 24/7. Okay. Right. So, 24. Am I clear where I did got this value? Yes, sir. This is not difficult, right? Yeah. Good. And then basically, then I need to basically define what are the contacts. So for that, let us look into localhost.cfg again initially. Okay. So I'm basically trying to look at this command so that you would understand. Okay. In a way, trying to tell that, okay, whenever I'm trying to use this stuff, what would typically happen. Okay. So let me go around over here. Okay. And then there is something called as templates.cfg. Okay. In templates.cfg, there are some contact details which are basically mentioned over here, Okay. So I can basically use a contact which is basically present over here. Let me use this name, which is generic contact. Okay. Initially, this might be confusing, but for now, it's okay. Okay. So we will be defining our own contacts. But in the first file, I would not want that. Okay. So did we define contact? Okay. And after we define contact, okay, we also probably need to define contact groups. Okay. So let me not define them. Let us see what happens. Okay. And then the next thing which I need to basically define is notification interval. So what is this notification interval is? It specifies basically number of minutes before each notification of the host being down should be sent out. Okay. It is number of minutes. So I would be writing it as notification underscore interval, and let me give it as 60. Okay. So notification, the next one which I need to write is notification underscore period. What is the time period when you want to send these notifications? I want to send these notifications 24/7. This is nothing but a time period. Okay. Right. Now, if you look into this, basically, even there is one example definition over here, and for every item it is trying to tell what is that you can write. There is a whole description over here, right? So basically, okay, it is trying to tell that you must specify at least one contact or contact group in the host definition. If you specify contact also is fine, or contact group is also fine. Now, right? So all of this information is basically present over here. But it's okay. Let us try to basically do this. Okay. So now let me go to here, webserver.cfg file, and let me try to do this. So I have added a host. Okay. So what I would do is now. Okay. So in this same objects folder, I'll be adding, if you look into this, there is localhost.cfg. In the same way, I'll be writing, okay, webserver.cfg. webserver.cfg. And in this, I will try to define the host. Okay. Now I've defined the host. Okay. The moment I define the host, okay, let us try to see if Nagios UI is showing us everything. Let us try to see if Nagios UI is basically showing us it or not. Let me go to the object definitions. Let me go to hosts. It shows only one host. Let me refresh. Okay. Let me go to hosts again. So is Nagios showing? No. Nagios will not show any object definitions. Any object definitions till you restart Nagios. Right? So Nagios will not show new object definitions, new objects till we restart Nagios. Okay. But there is one problem in Nagios. There is one catch here. If there is any mistake, in configuration file, in object definition, and if you try to restart Nagios, Nagios will not start. Okay. So there is a way to verify your Nagios configuration. Okay. So which is referred as pre-flight check. Okay. Right. So I will basically type the command. Now, first, let's enable webserver.cfg in main Nagios configuration. Shall we do that? Okay. So I will go over here. Okay, and then I will basically change this nagios.cfg, and now I am adding a new cfg file over here. Okay, I need sudo permissions. So right, so right, I'll be adding cfg underscore file equals to user local Nagios etc objects. Okay, and over here webserver.cfg. Yes, you need to enable this. Let me try to take the screenshot, and in this what we are trying to enable is this part. Okay. Okay, so our Nagios configurations will look good once we understand template also, but it's okay. It's okay. You have to start at some point, right? Okay, so let me call it as 14. Right. Now I have saved my Nagios configuration, but remember, before I do anything, I need to do pre-flight checks. So pre-flight checks is, if in user local Nagios there is bin. Okay, so let me try to put the whole path, user local Nagios. Okay, bin, there is Nagios. Okay, and then we will try -v. -v is verify, my configuration file, which is present in user local Nagios dot CFG. Now, let me try to write this command first. Okay. So you can give relative paths, but I am trying to give the full path. Okay. So you can do that. Okay. Ah man. Right. Sudo. So what is it trying to tell? There is error in configuration file for reading. Okay. So our Nagios configuration file has an error in reading. Strange. How can my Nagios error file can have the stuff in reading? Okay. Sir, sudo is run as administrator, sir. Okay. Fine. So let me get into cd etc and then ls-al. Okay. So it is trying to tell that you don't have permissions. So let me become root user for some time. I don't want to deal with this permission issues. So cd user local nagios, and now let me try to run the same command. I have become a root user now. Let us see what happens. Okay, it is trying to tell that no, there is some error. Okay, fine. If there is an error, it is fine. Now what I'll try to do is I will try to, there is something wrong in this configuration file, so let me change this configuration. Oh, there is something wrong, man. Wrong is not this. This is what is. Yeah, my bad, sir. It is definitely my bad. Okay. So permission denied. So let me run sudo. So it is trying to tell that when I run this, okay, my path was wrong. Okay, it is trying to tell that you could not add a generic contact. Okay, and there is something wrong with using a generic contact because it is not defined anywhere. So there is something going wrong with respect to contacts. Okay, so what is this error and why is this happening? Okay, so it's okay. We are getting this error. Okay, so right. Okay, because these errors will give us understanding with respect to inheritance. Okay, so when we try to learn object inheritance, all of these errors will be clarified. Now I am getting an object error, yes or no? Yeah, right. So since I get this object error, what I would try to do is, now I would try to take the easier path. Okay, now okay, this error has to be resolved. Okay, so if you basically look into it, there is an error in webserver.cfg. Okay, this error is resolved and it has to do something with generic contacts. Okay, but for the time being I would use the syntax adopted by localhost.cfg. What is it I'm trying to do? I'm trying to use a syntax adopted by localhost.cfg. Okay, we have to still resolve that problem, but I'm taking a shortcut. Okay, so I will try to tell webserver.cfg. Okay, this is shortcut. This is not a right thing, but let us see. So what I would try to do is I will basically now open vi objects slash localhost.cfg, right? In localhost.cfg, I will try to look into how he has defined it, because this is the reason why we would want a sample file. So he is just trying to tell that, okay, define host, use something called as Linux server. Now, first thing what I would try doing is, let me copy this, okay, and paste the same thing, okay, and then rather than giving the local host, I will give a different stuff. I will try to tell that this is use Linux server, host underscore name is web server, alias name is web server, and what is the IP address of our web server, whatever we have taken over here. What is that I am trying to do now? Okay. I am trying to do this. Okay. So, let me try to go and check whether this works or not. Okay. Now I will try doing this. Okay. I will basically change vi objects slash web server dot cfg. Okay. Right, sudo vi web server dot cfg, and let me remove all the lines. Okay, and now let me insert this new one. Okay, and then let me try to do the pre-flight check. Is it working now? Yes. So there is something in Nagios which we still need to understand, which is some, which has something to do with this inheritance, right? Now, still it's okay. Okay. Now, let's rerun pre-flight check. Okay. So if you run pre-flight check this time, you will not have any issues. Okay, it says that everything is going good now for you. Okay. So let me save this image. Okay. Right. Okay, since the pre-flight checks are have passed, let's restart Nagios. Okay, so for that I think we have been using systemctl sudo systemctl. Okay, Nagios dot service restart. Oh, man, I always do this. Sorry, systemctl restart Nagios dot service. I'm very much used to that service conventions. Right. Okay. Now, systemctl restart. Apache 2. Okay. Now I have restarted Nagios. Okay. Service. Restart Nagios. Okay. And then let me go into the web browser. Refresh this page. Get into hosts. Sorry, is in two hosts. Okay, so I have basically selected the host, and you are seeing web server added. Okay, so now what we would try to do is, let us try to look into services, or let me try to look into services. Okay, so in services, okay, there is no web server over here. If you see, there is no web server is not around. Yes? Web server is not around because we have just host which is added. We have not added services. Okay. So what are services? What are services, sir? Service is actually the check which you want to perform, right? Okay. So service is the check which we want to perform. Okay. So let's copy one simple service from localhost.cfg into webserver.cfg. Okay. But to write this service, we need to understand web definitions, object definitions. But today I'm just giving you an overview, right? So now let me open vi objects, okay, / localhost.cfg. And in this, if you basically look at this, okay, so are you seeing a service called as ping? Okay, I will try to basically, okay, copy paste this. Okay, ideally you should be using the service name and then trying to do, but it's okay. Use local underscore service, and host name is, what is my host name? My host name is web server. So let us try to see if this works out. Add this to your web server dot cfg. Okay, so yeah, right now, okay, so vi objects, I need to use sudo vi objects and then web server dot cfg, and let me try to add this check. Okay, now what is the next thing which you need to do every time? Run pre-flight check. Okay, so if you remember the pre-flight check, right, so it says everything is fine. Okay, and then systemctl restart Nagios, and then systemctl restart Apache 2. Now let me go to the web page, refresh this web page, get into hosts, now get into services. Okay. Let us wait for some time. Okay. So it is still pending. It would take some time for this test to be completed. But yeah, no matter whatever it is, whether it is success or a failure. Okay. So am I able to see a new service now, which we have called it as ping? Yeah. Run pre-flight check, and if it is successful, restart Nagios and navigate to web page. Okay, so now let me save this. This would be my 19. Good, right? So let me refresh. Let me click on services again. Okay, so after some time you should see the state of this. So is my ping working out? Okay, so it is trying to tell that your status is good, right? So our next steps would be, okay, creating object definitions from scratch, understanding inheritance, understanding inheritance. Okay, there is something called as inheritance that is happening. If you remember, due to that inheritance itself, we got an error. Okay, in real time, do we create these service definitions and host definitions, sir? Then why, if you don't define them, why are the companies paying you? It is your job. Yes, you define these services and host definitions. The only input which you would get is, what are the different services that are running on your servers? What are the different services that are running on your servers? So am I clear on this? So what would be our next steps? Our next steps would be understanding, how can I effectively write these configuration files? Okay, so to write this configuration files, I have to worry about a couple of things. One is object definitions. The next thing which I need to worry about is inheritance. Am I clear on this? So let us try to build our own monitoring around inheritance, around object definitions, right, around creating notifications, and we will try to build our own system monitoring system. Okay, our monitoring system as such, which would basically help us in resolving issues. So did we got an at least overview what is our workflow? You have to write object configurations, and these object configurations which you basically write should adhere to pre-flight checks, because if your pre-flight checks have failed, NagOS will not start. Am I clear on this, sir? So let me stop it at that, and we will meet again tomorrow to continue this discussion.
Thanks for watching. For more videos, subscribe our channel and click on bell icon.